All right, everybody. So, team on the Rum Zoom call, the last day in February, and it's leap day. Today's been a really weird day here today, so I'm like, maybe it's because it's leap day. It's just been weird. The vibe's been weird. I don't know if anybody else experienced that, but I have all these notes, and I had all these great intentions of making a PowerPoint for you guys today, and life happened. I have a sick kid. He didn't nap. It's just been a long day. So I guess no better ironic way to explain why the PowerPoint's not done, because my kids came first. So I hope you have a pen and paper, and I'll try to talk slow. And then I'm presenting on this topic to another coach's team late in the week. So I will definitely get my PowerPoint finished by then, and I'll get it to you guys too. So I apologize that there's no visual, but hopefully my melodious voice just giving you this information is enough. So tonight what I want to talk to you guys about is balancing motherhood or parenting. I don't see any dads on the call, but that doesn't mean that there are not dads who are coaches. Balancing parenting with coaching. And not everybody on the call has kids, but that doesn't matter, because I think that a lot of these points really apply to just busy people in general and people who have a lot of commitments. But also, even if you don't have kids yet, you have coaches who have kids. And so I'm hoping that these are tips that you can use to help them, because I would say that one of the biggest questions I get asked is how do you balance and how do you juggle being a mom and being a coach? And the first thing I have to say about that is a lot of times I don't, and I'm struggling because I'm not perfect, and I'm doing my best to try to, you know, keep a lot of balls in the air and do my best, because I'm only human, right? But so there's maybe no magic secret to this, but I'm going to tell you some of the tips that have helped me. And just because not everybody in here maybe knows my family situation or how long I've been coaching, I've been a coach now for almost 4 years. And I have three kids, ages 6 and a half, 4 and a half, and 2. And so I started coaching when my middle daughter was about 8 months old. And then I coached through my third pregnancy and having a newborn. And I've done this while working outside the home and outside of Beachbody as a teacher. And I've also done this job while being a stay-at-home mom and working my business, so I'm no longer teaching. So I've really kind of done this business through a lot of different parenting scenarios and a lot of different work scenarios, if that makes sense. So I've kind of tried to compile a list of what I feel like are my biggest tips for success when at least attempting to balance. So if you've got a pen and paper, and don't be afraid to holler at me in the chat box, or save your questions till the end if that works better, and I will do my best to answer them. So when it comes to balancing motherhood or parenting or being a busy, committed, or maybe overcommitted person with coaching, I think a lot of this is stuff you guys have heard before. And my first tip is something you've heard like in every coach training and every call that you've ever heard, is to set hours. And I know that that's really, really, really hard to do. As a parent, I think it's especially important, guys, to take advantage of your mom windows, okay, where you're kid-free. And for me, those mom windows are not the most ideal times in my day to work. I'm going to be quite honest with you. Like, I don't feel like getting up at 5 in the morning to work. After I get my kids to bed, 8 o'clock at night, 8:30 at night, I don't feel like working. Today, I was up with my son like a bajillion times last night because he didn't feel good. And then I finally got the kids to lay down, and I'm like, all I want to do is take a nap. I'm so tired, right? And then he didn't take a nap anyways, but I didn't feel like working. I felt like taking a nap. So I'm not saying don't ever take a nap. I'm not saying don't get sleep. That's not the point. The point is you need to take advantage of those mom windows that are few and far between, and it's not convenient, but success is not convenient. Okay, getting out of bed at 5 in the morning to get your power hour in is not convenient, but it may be the only time you get that's uninterrupted all day. Am I right or am I right? So take advantage of those mom windows, even when it's painful. And I think the same goes for just anybody who's working a full-time job or who is busy. It may not be a mom window to you, but it's a window of uninterrupted focused time, whether it be late at night or early in the morning or wherever it may be for you. Set those hours. And so for me, it's early morning, after kids are in bed, and nap time. Do I work at all three of those time blocks every single day? Not necessarily. I really try to set my schedule at the beginning of the week for the week, and I make sure that I time block some time that I'm not working. And so we'll talk about that too. But take advantage of the mom windows, because that's, you can at least get 15 minutes to an hour of uninterrupted focused time, depending, no matter what your family situation is. Everybody can find those pockets of time. And let's see. Hold on. Erin, I'm going to mute you, or maybe you can mute you. Gotcha. Let's see. Where was I going with mom windows? And when it comes to mom windows, I think one thing that has been a learning experience for me with this business, and I'm trying to get better at it, is I have to realize that those mom windows of time, because kids are unpredictable, those windows of time can be unpredictable sometimes. Am I right or am I right? So the crappy thing is sometimes you end up looking really unprofessional. If you schedule a call at 1:30 in the afternoon, and guess what happens? Your kids aren't sleeping at 1:30 in the afternoon, right? So one thing I've had to learn after hurting a few coaches' feelings, or being unprofessional and being late, or having to skip or reschedule, is don't schedule calls at 1:30 in the afternoon if you can avoid it, right? Because yes, it's a mom window of time, but it's not a reliable mom window of time. 9 o'clock at night would be a more reliable window of time, right? Are you 100% guaranteed? Like, I had a call with Carla the other night, and her daughter was having a meltdown, right? So her husband had to deal with it. 9 o'clock at night. It happens. But you're like 99% sure that it's probably going to be a better time to talk than at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, right? So I'm just saying, it's not perfection. You're not going to be perfect. But when looking at your mom windows of time throughout the week, especially if you've got really little ones, realize that depending on who you're meeting with, or talking with, or what your commitment is, some people may be more accommodating than others. And the last thing you ever want to do is look like a jackass because you constantly have to cancel or postpone or reschedule calls because your kids are interrupting it. Then it's not a good time. Does that make sense? So I think along with the mom windows, you have to be flexible, but you also have to realize, like, what can you really realistically get done during that pocket of time? Make sense? And along with setting hours during those mom windows, my number two, and it's really closely related to this, am I talking too fast, guys? I hope not. Okay. Is time blocking, which, yes, is related to setting your business hours, right? But when I say time blocking, I mean time blocking time where you're not working is just as important as blocking the time where you are working. And what do I mean by this? And again, this is something you guys have heard 101 times. But what do I mean by this? You can't be a slave to your phone. The worst feeling in the world is for your kid to be like, mommy, 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 watch me. I'm hanging upside down on the monkey bars. I built this thing out of Legos. I want you to play with me. I want you to color me. And you're on your phone messaging someone how to purchase a challenge pack. No. Do you really want, and I'm not a perfect parent, and I'm not going to say I haven't done that, but do you really want this time with your little ones, whether you're a stay-at-home mom or whether you're a working mom or whether your kids are in high school or whether they're little, you don't need your time with them to be taken up with Beachbody. That's just bullshit, and it's not worth it, okay? It's not worth it. They are your why, so they deserve that time and focus. And maybe it's not kids. Maybe you don't have kids yet, but maybe it's your spouse, okay? They deserve that time and focus. Your partner does too. So this is something I had to constantly remind myself, along with setting business hours that are work hours, that you are focused. You also have to block that time that you are not slaved to your phone. You're not chained to it. You're not a messenger, okay? And I just think it's really, really important. And for me, that's meant when I block my time throughout, you know, through the week, that might mean like Thursday night is date night in with my man. And that means I don't have my phone out. It doesn't mean like date night when I watch Grey's Anatomy and he's in the room with me and I'm messaging people back trying to hit success club. Like, that's cool. but like an actual date night where I put my phone away and I'm plugged in with my spouse. Same thing with my kids. Like if I'm taking them to the zoo, the phone can stay in the diaper bag. I don't need to be working Beachbody. Whoever's messaging me can wait. And if they're worth my time, they need to understand that my family is my priority. And one of the greatest compliments I got was from another coach at the New Leader Conference where I was with Bridget. She was asking me how I managed to manage this business with small kids at home. And I said, it's really, really hard. And my biggest advice for you is time blocking. And she's like, you must be pretty good at that because I'll message you and I won't hear back for like 3 hours. Yep. Because I don't need to message you back right away because I'm with my kids. Some days are easier than others. But I think as long as setting your business hours, you also need to set family hours, family time, and put your phone in a drawer, put your phone in your purse, shut your computer off, close your office door, whatever you need to do to really focus in on your family because it's not fair to them. And it's also not fair to your challengers or your coaches who you're giving like half-assed messages to because you're paying attention to your kids kind of, okay, or your partner kind of. And with that time blocking, I really, really think it's important as a mom to include self-care in that time blocking. And easier said than done, I know. But I know Bridget the other day went and got a massage and this was like a couple of weeks ago, I think, or after New Leader Conference. She was really feeling stressed and she unplugged and didn't work her business and didn't hang out with her kids, didn't hang out with her partner. She went and did something for her. And I really think that's important, even if it's just a hot bath with a magazine or watching your show where, you know, you're not plugged into 100 and other things. If you don't block that time for yourself, it's not going to happen. And if you put yourself last all the time, you're not going to grow as a person or in your business because you're just going to feel run ragged all the time. Okay. So I know I struggle with this too, but really, really, really important. So you're setting business hours and you're setting family hours and you're making sure to include you hours. This is so important, guys. And it's so hard. We are always the last people we take care of, right? And we tell our challengers not to do it, but then we do it. We take care of ourselves last or not at all. So I really, really think that's important. And if I'm not going too fast, that leads me to my next point, which is when it comes to time blocking time for yourself, something that is really, really important for self-care is personal development. Yes? So we know that's one of the three vitals. But guys, it doesn't always have to be business books. Parenting books are okay too. Or books about you and growing as a person are good too. So it doesn't always have to be business books. But I know like Brené Brown, a lot of you guys have read The Gifts of Imperfection, right? She wrote The Gifts of Imperfect Parenting. And that's another really great one. And I feel like sometimes we think that it's just got to be business related. But everything is connected, right? So if you read a book that maybe you read a book with your spouse or your partner, if you don't have kids, to develop that relationship, to work on that, I think it's really, really important to also be connecting the parenting piece and the relationship piece of your life and the self-care piece with your personal development. So don't just focus on those business books because I do think it's all connected. And I just saw something pop up in the chat box. Meditation's been huge for me lately for PD. Yeah. And that comes with setting aside that time for self-care, guys. If you can find, I shouldn't say find the time, if you can make the time to meditate, it's huge. So I love to pick Rachel's brain about that. But I definitely think just don't overlook, that was my fourth point, don't overlook parenting books or, relationship-driven books as part of your personal development. Because I really think you're going to find that when you feel more connected to yourself and grounded when it comes to being a parent or being a partner, or being a spouse, that's going to be reflected in the way you run your business too. So that's some advice. That's my challenge for you guys. All right. Any questions so far? Good. Okay. I'll go on to my next point. Hold on really quick. I just want to make sure. My next point, this is point number, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 5. When it comes to your kids, realize, and I hope this doesn't come off as the right, wrong way to anybody, because I'm not saying use your kids, okay? But realize what a resource you have with your kids for connecting to other parents. And what is the point of making these connections with other parents? That builds your network, right? So get involved. Get to know those other parents at school, preschool, your mom and yoga class, your mom, baby and yoga class, or whatever it may be. But most likely you already have something in common, right? Your kids. And so I feel like, you know, I've noticed that Sarah Klepp, I don't think she's on the call tonight, but she has a massive amount of dance moms that are on her team. Have you guys noticed that? She was like, this person's another dance mom. Well, duh, because she has a huge connection with these women. She spends a lot of time with them. So this is a natural way to connect with people. So start talking to people when you pick up your kids, or start talking to people at sporting events or at daycare or wherever it may be, and start forming those connections with them, because and adding them to your network, because I really think that it's a natural way to connect with other like-minded, not all of them may be like-minded, but you all at least have something in common. And some of those women may be craving a connection and a healthy way to get healthier, and someone who cares about them more than you know. I know I was, when I first started staying home with my kids, one of the first things I noticed was that I didn't know anybody who stayed home with their kids. I was a teacher, so I knew a lot of people who were home with their kids in the summer, but when I was home with my kids full time, I didn't know anybody. I was so lonely and isolated. And if you've been there, you know how it feels. It's isolating. And it was really hard for me to make connections with other moms, but it was really, really important for my happiness, but also for their happiness. And then guess what? Obviously, they're going to ask what you do, and obviously, they're going to want to be a part of it, at least in time. So definitely be meeting people through your kids, okay, and adding them to your network. Let's see. Ellen, she says, pregnant mamas, groups on Facebook for mothers who are also doing the same month. Yes. That's huge. Hold on. I got to send Jason a text here because I need the cord with the computer. This is how great we communicate in our house. Can I have the cord to the computer, honey? I don't know where it is, but I don't want my computer to die on my call. Thank you. Yes, Ellen is right. And I just realized that another mom at my preschool added me to like a crunchy mama's Madison's group. And I'm not like super crunchy, but crunchy enough that, you know, I felt cool to get added to this group. Well, sure as heck better believe I'm going to friend some of those crunchy mamas, right? So there's a lot of Facebook groups, moms. There's one that I'm in for moms who run in my area, all right? So don't be afraid to connect with those other, whether you work or a crunchy mama. What's a crunchy mama? Crunchy mama's like, I live in Madison, right? So it's like hippie central in Wisconsin. So crunchy mama, like anybody who, you know, like cloth diapers or breast, natural minded. Yep, they're crunchy, like granola. Cloth diapers, organic baby food, breastfeeds their kids till their kids want to wean, you know, you're picturing, all right? So I had a little bit of crunchy in me. Some of those things apply to me, not all of it, but enough that I connect to some of these crunchy mamas, right? So lots has changed the 2002. Yeah, I love it. So connect with those other moms, even if you're a full-time working mom, or maybe you're not a mom. That's cool too. Maybe you're a dog mom, you know? Maybe you have a partner that you can meet some like-minded women through your spouse, all right? There's a lot of different ways to connect to women who are craving connection and who probably want and need your help, and you don't realize it, and they may not even realize it. So don't be afraid. Get involved in those social media groups and start expanding your network through your kids. let's see. I'm looking, kind of a piggybacking on meeting people through your kids and connecting with people through your kids. I don't know if you guys have noticed the amount of parenting questions I ask on Facebook. People love to talk about parenting, and they love to talk about themselves. And everybody thinks that they know what's best, right? And what's right. And yes, you can open a whole can of worms. So I definitely don't ask questions that are too controversial because it'll just get me heated. Get me heated and I'll get mad at people, you know, and I don't want to go there on my Facebook page. But like today I asked about flying with kids. I really want to know, really and truly, because I'm leaving next week and I'm scared to fly with all three kids. I'm like, how am I going to keep them entertained on the plane? But people love to talk about parenting because it's a reality for so many people. So ask questions, pregnancy related questions. I don't know if you're following Amanda Dewey. She just had a baby. She's asking a million questions about newborns. All right. Maybe you want to get pregnant someday. Maybe you're a dog mama. Maybe you want to ask, I've asked questions about connecting with my spouse. How do you find times to connect with your spouse? Right. People like answering these questions. And what does it do when people answer questions on your Facebook page? It brings people in. They feel connected to you. They see a personal side of you and it gets their eyes on your page. Yes. Let's see. What does Mandy says? My speakers are not working. I can't hear audio. She's going to log into a different computer. We got you, Mandy. And I'm recording too. So definitely use parenting and just household related questions, even if it's with pets or household chores or balancing tasks or connecting with your partner. These are great questions to ask because people want to talk about themselves. They want you to be interested, not just interesting. And so these are natural questions to ask because you probably are really curious to know. If nothing else, it's an interesting discussion, right? So don't be afraid to put those out there on social media because people want to talk about it. All right, let us talk about my next thought. And this is kind of a long-winded one, and I hope I'm not talking too fast, guys. But if you are a mama or a dog mama, or maybe you're getting married soon. I see someone on here who's getting married soon. There's lots of ways this could apply, different ways it could apply to your life. But make that part of your brand. I want you guys to, if you've got kids right now, I want you to think, are your kids part of your brand? Because it should be. Because it's a huge part of who you are, right? And that's a huge way other people are going to connect to you. So your kids should be part of your brand. And I want you to think about what kind of mom you are and how people can relate to that as your brand. So I'm going to give some examples. Maybe you're crunchy mama, right? And maybe you make all your own baby food. Or maybe you don't believe in baby food because you want kids to be baby-led weaning where they're eating their big, big pieces of food, okay? Which that wasn't a very good description, but you know what I'm trying to say. So maybe you want, there are ways, you as a mom, are you, I know Jenny O'Malley, she's a hockey mom. That's a huge part of her reality. That's a huge part of her time commitment. So that's part of her brand, okay? Ellen Mao, she is pregnant, very pregnant at this moment and has a baby at home already. And she's a home birthing mom. So she's going to give birth at home, guys. She's a very natural mama. Ellen's pretty crunchy. So she's going to, that's part of her brand. And she's going to be able to reach a whole bunch of moms who relate to her because of that. So I want you to think, am I making my parenting, whatever role it plays in your life, even if you don't have kids yet, okay? Are you making it part of your brand for a way to connect with other people? And what kind of mom are you? And not to say that you're stereotype, but there's a way that you could brand yourself as a type of mom. So are you a dance mom? Are you a mom of girls? I know Bridget is a mom of very, very busy little boys. Okay. And that's part of her brand. And I want you to be showing that more to people. Meg May's got three boys. Yes. And they're in drama, and I love following her. And her boys are definitely part of her brand. So it is part of what makes you you, and it's a part of what makes you connected to other people. So I want you to start thinking about how you can use that as part of your brand and start doing things like integrating fit pregnancy, for example. Maybe you're a nursing, like a breastfeeding mom. Well, how do you manage your nutrition while you're breastfeeding? Make sure you get enough calories, okay? Healthy eating. Maybe a big part of your brand is eat for the family. That's part of my brand. So I would definitely be sharing recipes when I can, getting my kids involved in the kitchen when I can, take some video of that, post pictures of that. People want to know. Maybe you're not a cook, so that's not part of your brand. That's okay. Because there's lots of moms who can relate to the fact that they don't like to cook. you know, so that's okay. I think fit family, do your kids work out with you? How do you find time to work out with small children or older children? So maybe your children are involved in activities or sports. So talk to me about that, right? So there's a lot of different directions you could go. Your dog mama, talk about getting out with your pup, outside, running. You know, there's lots of different ways that you can make your family, whether it be kids or not, part of your brand. So I want you to start thinking about how that fits in an authentic way, and not in a forced way, because that feels yucky, but in an authentic way. How can you reflect your family as part of your brand? And I definitely think people want to know, how are you juggling it? What are you doing to keep your family healthy? Okay. That was kind of long-winded. But everybody's brand with their family is going to look different, because we're all different. And that's great, because that means you're going to connect with different people. And I think to piggyback on that, guys, you don't need to be super mom. Okay? That is not relatable at all. In fact, I think that it's not particularly attractive. Like, we feel defeated. Or remember when we had that big, maybe you don't remember, but there was all this hubbub on our Team on the Run page after Megan Ewaldson, who's a top coach, had her baby and posted her ab pictures, right? And some people were like, that's amazing. And other people on our team were pissed because they thought it was unrealistic and unhealthy image to promote. Whatever your take may be, the point is, I think part of what made people so uncomfortable with that post is it came across very super momish. And that's defeating. We're not in competition with each other. If you always show perfection, it doesn't make you relatable, and it doesn't make people want to reach out to you. So you've got to show the good and the bad, but spin it in a way. You don't need to have a perfect body. You don't need to have a perfect house. You don't need to do 1,001 Pinterest projects. People relate to you for who you are, okay? So just make sure that you're not only showing the highlight reel all the time. Does that make sense? And yes, you're going to alienate people if you post an ab picture, whatever. Megan, I'm sure, was not trying to alienate people, because there's a lot of people who did relate to that. But just make sure that you're not only showing supermom, because it's not real. People know it's not real, and it feels yucky, okay? So don't put that pressure on yourself. Let's talk about involving your kids. And that could be involving them, you know, involving your family. It doesn't have to be your kids, but involving your family in this business. I think that involving them in your workouts and cooking and that kind of stuff, like we talked about, that's awesome. But I think also involving them in your dreams and your goals for this business, if you've got big goals, or maybe you have little goals, and that's okay too. But I told my kids when I registered for the cruise that I was taking them on this cruise, and I showed them the ship. And I showed them the ocean, and I showed them, and we've been talking about it all year. And to be able to give them that gift is huge. And to be able to show them that I worked towards this for them, okay? And that if daddy had to put them to bed a couple nights because mommy was on a call because it was time blocked, right? And I've been with them all day, it's because I'm working towards something for them. And I think that even little kids can understand that. So I think involving your family, even your spouse, your partner in your vision, if it's just up here in our head all the time, then sometimes people might get frustrated with us with the amount of time and energy we're putting in. You need to share that vision. You need to make it accessible and exciting to your partner and to your kids too, because I think that they need to know why you're doing what you're doing, and that so much of it is for them too. It's not selfish. All right. So involving them on a day-to-day basis, but also just in the big picture, right? I'm looking. Okay. I've got like 3 more points. This is a big one, and I know that for me it's a huge one, and I know that a lot of people feel like it's unrealistic, so just bear with me. But outsource what you can, whether you have kids or not. You can start small with this, but I 100% guarantee you, and I will get to what I mean by outsourcing, that if you're trying to make a career of this, or even if you're not, but you're feeling overwhelmed by the time commitment, Is there something in your life that someone else could do almost as good as you're doing it? It would be, you know, acceptable, and it would relieve a vast amount of stress for you. So I started small, because when I first started this business, you saw my first year in this business, I was making, what, $2,000 a year. So, I mean, I really wasn't outsourcing a whole lot. Okay, let's be honest. But thank you, Magme. I was just going to say that. You're amazing. But as I've grown in my business, I've started to outsource more things. And it started small, and now it's gotten bigger. But bear with me for a minute. Meg said she just hired a cleaning lady. Yes, that was on my goal list for, I would say, 2 years, probably 2 years. It was on. Every Monday, I'd write out my goals. I will be hiring someone to clean my house twice a month, right? And my kids weren't part of that vision, because they don't really get it, but my husband was part of that vision. You know, like, I can't wait until I can hire someone to help me clean my house. Why? Because it was a huge stress reliever, and because when my cleaning person comes every other Monday, because now I can finally afford it, guess what I can do while my cleaning person is cleaning and my kids are napping? I can work. And I make more in that 2 hours while they're cleaning than I'm paying them. Does that make sense? So in the long run, not only does it relieve my stress, but I'm able to get more work done. So I think that outsourcing is huge. If you can hire anything, something done, your lawn mowed, something to take it off your plate, so that you have time to work more and see more of a return on your time, monetarily wise, or you get just more stress off your plate, or maybe you can take something off your spouse's plate so that in turn, maybe your spouse is really good with technology and could help you with some of your like page stuff. Well, he'd probably rather be doing that than mowing the lawn, you know, right? So maybe you can hire the neighbor kid to mow the lawn and your spouse could help you with something with your business. There's lots of different ways to look at outsourcing, but it doesn't have to cost a ton. But is there something in your world that you could pay someone else $10 an hour to do for you? Because in the long run of this business, you're going to be making a lot more than $10 an hour. And the mental sanity is 100% worth it. Okay. So for example, and part of the reason these shirts are so slow coming out is because my assistant, she's a former student of mine. And as I used to teach high school, and I hired her $10 an hour to come help me with some Beachbody related stuff. So she had some yucky stuff come up and had a funeral to attend. So she halfway through the project, she got held up. So life happens, right? Whatever. But was it worth paying her $10 an hour to help me get those shirts out to all of you? I had over 75 different shipments to sort through. Yes, it was worth $10 an hour. Are you kidding me? Yes. So happy that I hired someone to help me with that. So just think, what could I outsource? And maybe it's not tomorrow, but could you put on your goal list for 6 months from now, or for 1 year from now, or 2 years from now? That cleaning person was on my goal list for a hell of a long time before I could finally justify it in my budget. And I told my husband, if I don't make more money from getting this outsourced, enough to pay for this person plus some, give me 6 months. And if it doesn't work, then we'll let this person go. Right. But of course it's going to work, because you're going to be able to put that time into your business instead of cleaning your house, instead of folding your laundry. Could you pay the neighborhood kid $10 to come over and help you fold and put away laundry? Yes. Yes, you could. If that was time that you could spend on your business instead and make more than $10 an hour. So maybe not tomorrow, but in a year from now, could you? For sure. And it would save your mental sanity. So just think about that. And I know that some of you guys are probably already tuned me out, because you're like, my husband's never going to go for that. I could never hire. I could never outsource. But you could. Maybe not today, but put it on your goal list and start dreaming about it, because, oh my God, it's so worth it. There's nothing you can't outsource. Hi, my groceries delivered to me. That doesn't cost me any extra. All right. Hi, V. Yes. So it doesn't cost me any extra. If it's $100, they deliver it to me for free. Are you kidding me? That saved, it saves at least an hour a week for me to get to the store with three kids, you know, that kind of thing, to get to the store, the extra time it takes to shop with the kids, the impulse buys, to get back from the store, to, that's an hour of my time that I can spend working my business while my kids are napping. Done deal. That didn't cost me anything, but it just took me a little bit of time to like figure out how to do it. So I'm obviously very passionate about outsourcing. Amanda told me to do it. for years and I didn't listen to her because I didn't think I could afford it. But oh my gosh, my sanity is 100% worth it. So you want to know more about what someone could do for you, talk to me because I've got a whole list of things she could get outsourced. It's a game changer, right? All right, I'm almost done. I've got like two more things to talk about and then I'll open it up for questions. I think my next tip for balancing this business with your family is be kind to yourself. It's really hard, guys, but shitty family days happen when you don't get much done. Today was one of those days for me. What have I gotten done for my business? Not much, okay? But I'm still gonna pull myself together and get as much done as I can, show up, because my biggest lesson in this business is show up every single day, even if you're not bringing your A game. Do the bare minimum, get some sleep, and hit the ground running tomorrow, because tomorrow's a new day. It just keeps swimming. But if you constantly feel defeated when you have hard family days, if you constantly feel defeated and use it as an excuse to push your business aside every single day, it's too hard. My kids didn't nap. I was up all night. My dog's sick. My mom's sick. I'm sick. I'm pregnant. My baby was up. I mean, there's like 101 reasons, right? Life happens. My kids had all these baseball games or all, you know, you get shitty mom days happen. Hard family days happen. And there are days that we don't bring our A game and we don't get much done. And I know like Ellen and I have had these texting conversations like, oh my gosh, it's, you know, 8 o'clock at night and I got nothing done and I'm so tired. And what's the bare minimum you can do that's going to move your business forward? Take 30 minutes, pound it out, go to bed. Tomorrow's a new day. And you've got to be kind to yourself because we're all human beings. Melissa McAllister built a multi-million dollar business for herself and her kids were small when she started. And I guarantee you she had shitty mom days where she did the bare minimum. And then she got up the next day and started fresh and believed that she could do it. It's just when you let those overwhelming family days get the best of you and just happen to you over and over and over again, this business always takes the back seat then. So don't let it become a crutch, but be kind to yourself. Do the bare minimum and move along. It'll still be here tomorrow. That's the beauty of having your own business. It's not going anywhere. It is what you make it. So have some grace. All right. When I had a baby, brand new baby during this business, and in the hospital, I was with her. I was working still because I love it, because I love what I do. And I love sharing that part of my journey with my audience. And I love that. But was I bringing my A game? No, because she's more important. But I've still showed up. I showed up and did the bare minimum. And the same thing when she was really small, like when she was a brand new baby, not my prime moments as a coach, but I still just kept showing up, been knowing that she was my why and that it would all pan out if I kept swimming. So, and that's kind of the last thing I wanted to end on is your family, whether it be your spouse, partner, or your kids, or your future kids that you haven't had yet, but you're setting this amazing financial foundation for them, right? They're your why. So keep that in mind and don't blow off your business because you had a hard day, but at the same time, don't blow off your family for your business. I think that's a fine balance because at the end of the day, they're your why. And you need to keep moving forward for them, but keep your priorities in mind. Always. So I just hit you with a lot of information, but those are my top tips for trying to juggle it and maintain sanity. So I want to open it up, guys, for questions. I'm going to see if there's anything in the chat box. Yes, Hy-Vee and the cleaning lady. Talk to me. Questions, any questions you have, suggestions, comments, things you can relate to, troubles, concerns, anything you have, don't be afraid to unmute yourself and tell me what you're thinking.
I thought this was an awesome call. I think I can't wait for the replay so I can share this with my team.
Yay!
because I think that really for anybody who ever says that there is not anything to post about. I mean, you just gave a laundry list of things that I think people don't even think about, like including your family, your kids, your pets, your, you know, your struggles. And like, I loved some of your posts today, Jessica, just talking about like, you know, just not, you're just not having a great day, or you're just, you know, you didn't want to be an adult today, you know? And I think those are awesome things. One thing that struck me that I think is really key for a lot of people, is, you know, looking at your kids and their parents as potential customers and clients in the future. That is something that I never did initially, because I was always like, oh, I've been at work all day. I'm not here to make friends. I don't want to talk to anybody. Mm-hmm. So once I started in this business and stopped being that wallflower and actually like reaching out to people and talking with parents, it's amazing how many people you can reach that way, you know? So I think it was just awesome call. Great, great information.
Thank you. Thank you, Rachel. Yeah. Thank you. Other questions, guys, or thoughts, comments, reflections, struggles that you have? Amanda just posted something. She says she always falls back into the phone in the hand during kid time. Yeah, me too. I need these reminders just as much as I give them. Please don't think I'm giving these in like a all-knowing, like, I don't struggle with this kind of way. I do struggle with all these things. So this is a great reminder to me too. My phone is not more important than my kids or my spouse. Okay. It's hard. So thank you, Mandy. You're not alone in that. I think that every single person in here has probably been guilty of that, you know? And it comes back to that being kind to yourself, though, because you don't have to be super mom. They're okay. Your kids aren't scarred for life. Your spouse isn't scarred for life. But just be a gentle reminder, you know, to put the phone down. Your business isn't going to suffer. I promise. Other thoughts? Questions? I hope you're all thinking of ways you can incorporate your family as part of your brand if you're not doing much of it yet. And you're all unique in the kind of family you have. And I hope you're all thinking about things you can outsource in, you know, a year, 6 months, okay? A big Chalene Johnson, if you follow Chalene at all, a big tip of hers, a big thing she believes in, business tip of hers, is to spend money to make money. And in other words, to outsource somebody to do something for you so that you can make more than what you're paying them and be more efficient with your time, because time is so valuable, okay? Yes, Mandy said, I got a friend to take my son for a small amount of money one day a week for 3-4 hours so I can focus on business time. Just 1 week so far and so worth it. We even planned to split kid duty for no money. So win-win. Perfect. That's perfect. I know Jessica Vigeland and I work together a lot, and there's been more than one time that she's in Georgia and we're like, oh my gosh, wouldn't it be great if, have all this stuff to do, if I could send my kids to your house for an hour and then you could do the same thing tomorrow, you know, and we look at all we could get done. So I think, yes, you know, we try to do so much on our own instead of in a community of other moms. And I do think, obviously, those of you who work really want to value that time you're home with your kids. And if you're home with your kids and you're not working outside the home, you obviously don't want to ship your kids off every day. That's not why you're home. But oh my gosh, just the community aspect. Someone could watch your kids 1 hour a week and you could do the same for them. So much could get done. And then your kids would have a great time too. So that's a really good point. And that is, and anything that you're outsourcing, guys, is also a tax write-off. Remember that. So it's a business expense. It's people you're paying so you can get shit done. So it's huge. Other thoughts, questions, concerns, tips, anything I forgot, other family balancing family and coaching tips. Anybody have other tips that I didn't think of? Okay. Well, I won't keep you because I know it's late. And I really didn't want this call to be too long, but I hope it was helpful. Okay. I hope you have some good takeaways. You are so welcome. And oh man, let me know how it's going by the end of the week, balancing. It's hard, guys, and I struggle too. So I'm going to try to soak in these reminders to myself and also be thinking about any PD that you could do related to family, to relationships with your kids or with your partner, because that is all going to, it's all circular. It's all going to help you as a person and also in your business. So thank you guys so much, and I won't keep you, but if you think of anything else that you want to add or ask questions on, don't be afraid to, you know, comment in the group. And thank you guys. It's good to see you. All right. Good night.